Hi guys, a very good morning to one and all. Today, the topic of discussion is all about occupational lung diseases. Hi, this is Dr. Vishnu, senior resident from the Department of Pulmonary Medicine. Coming to the introduction, occupational lung disease is a multitude of diseases that can result from occupational exposure to dust, fumes, smoke, and biological agents. Coming to the background, the occupational lung diseases are widely classified into four major types. One is pneumoconiosis, the second thing is hypersensitivity pneumonitis, the third is bronchiolitis, and the fourth thing is occupational asthma. Pneumoconiosis is a disease which we get when the patients are exposed to inorganic particles and mineral dust. Here, the catch point is inorganic particles. If the patient inhales such inorganic particles, he will get pneumoconiosis. And hypersensitivity pneumonitis is after inhalation of organic dust, molds and chemicals. And you get bronchiolitis when you get exposed to noxious gases and fumes. That's what we experienced in styrene gas poisoning in Visakhapatnam recently. And occupational asthma is a type of asthma where the persons experience the symptoms of asthma while going to their workplace environment. So there are four criteria for the diagnosis. If these four are fulfilled, then we can say that this patient might be suffering from occupational lung disease. So the four criteria include documented exposure to an agent known to induce disease, a clearly defined latent period between exposure to the suspected agent and the development of disease symptoms. The third thing is these clinical manifestations are compatible with the recognized features of occupational lung disease. And you have to exclude the other differential diagnosis, which may present in a similar fashion to that of occupational lung disease, are to be ruled out. Only then you will be able to say that this patient is having occupational lung disease. So we will take a detailed history about the exposure. So the history includes specific contaminants involved and the presence of visible dust, chemical odors, the size and ventilation of workspaces, the use of respiratory protective equipment, whether co-workers have similar complaints, the temporal association of exposure at work and symptoms. We take a paper, we'll make all these points and we'll put check boxes and what all symptoms, important findings we have, we'll put a tick mark in that. So this is how we simply do this instead of remembering all these things. And we have to ask specific questions about alternative sources of exposure. That includes hobbies, home characteristics, exposure to secondhand smoke, and proximity to traffic or industrial facilities, short-term and long-term exposure to potential toxic agents in the distant past also must be considered. There are a battery of tests for occupational lung diseases. We will discuss specifically wherever it is required. But these are the whole lot of investigations that we order for a patient, if at all we are suspecting occupational lung disease. That includes pulmonary function tests. In majority of the diseases, like in the occupational lung diseases, you have got N number of diseases. Most of them present with a restrictive pattern. And there will be a reduced DLCO, diffusion capacity of carbon monoxide will be decreased. We know that whenever there is any disease to the alveoli or the interstitium, then the DLCO will be reduced. In all the interstitial lung disorders and in emphysema, the DLCO will be reduced. Since many of these disorders will be affecting the alveoli as well as the interstitium causing interstitial lung disease, there will be a decreased diffusion capacity. We will also order chest x-rays, the high resolution CT of thorax, skin prick testing or specific IgE antibody titers, especially for hypersensitivity pneumonitis, which will come to specific IgG precipitating antibody titers, and certain assays for specific cell-mediated immune responses. If you are expecting berylliosis, then you will do this Bell-PT test, which will come to. And if you are expecting tuberculosis, which is a commoner disease in case of silicosis patients, we'll do tuberculin skin test. And we will also do certain invasive tests like transbronchial lung biopsy and video-assisted thoracoscopic surgery. These are the advances that we do generally to get a biopsy specimen so that we'll be able to know the occupational lung disease which we are dealing with. And coming to the determinants of inhalational exposure, there are two important determinants. The first determinant is chemical and physical characteristic of inhaled agent. the chemical and physical characteristic. I'll give you an example. For example, water soluble gases, for example, ammonia and sulfur dioxide are considered to be the water soluble gases, and these are water soluble. So while we inhale that, it affects the proximal airways and thus tend to produce irritative and bronchoconstrictive responses. If we inhale a water insoluble gas like a nitrogen dioxide or phosgene gas, it is water insoluble, so the particles go inside and reach the lower respiratory tract, and they cause more or less bronchiolitis and alveolitis, producing chemical pneumonitis. So the water soluble gases will be somewhere, they will cause some disturbance in your major bronchi, and the water insoluble gases, they directly go to your alveoli and they cause alveolitis. And the second important determinant of inhalational exposure is the size of the particle. MMAD is mass median aerodynamic diameter. This is very important. When the size of the particle is more than 10 to 15 microns, then there will be deposition inside the nose and throat, and that particle doesn't reach your lower respiratory tract. If the size is somewhere around 2.5 to 10 microns, then the particle reaches tracheobronchial tree by bypassing nose and throat. When the particle size is less than 2.5 microns, it will reach the lower airways. This is applicable even for viruses. For example, your SARS-CoV-2 virus causing COVID-19 disease, the size is less than 2.5 microns. Therefore, it reaches your alveoli. And if the particle size is less than 0.1 microns, it will reach the alveoli. Then it crosses the alveolo-capillary membrane, enters the bloodstream, and get deposited in the extrapulmonary sites. So these particles are called nanoparticles, and the companies are preparing nanoparticles because they won't get deposited in the lung. They will be deposited somewhere else in the body, which can be removed by the scavengers present in the human body. Coming to the first disorder under pneumoconiosis, that is asbestos-related diseases. Asbestos is naturally occurring fibrous magnesium silicate. See, it is a silicate. What is silica? Silica is nothing but silicon dioxide. When silica is mixed with some other mineral, something like magnesium, we call it as a silicate. So if some mineral is added to silica, it is called silicate. And here, asbestos is nothing but a fibrous magnesium silicate. We have types of asbestos mineral. We have got two major types. One is chrysotile, and the second thing is amphibole. The amphibole includes amosite, anthophyllite, crocodolite. The chrysotile is nothing but a type of fiber which is slender and it is spiral in nature. Therefore, it is called a serpentine fiber. And amphibole is a rod-like fiber which get deposited. And amphibole is the one which is more dangerous when compared to your chrysotile. Who are at risk and what occupations are at major risk for getting asbestosis? So these are the occupations, especially the plumbers, pipe fitters, steam fitters, electricians, and the industries include the shipbuilding and repairing industries. So let me give you a background about the various diseases which are included, which are associated with asbestos exposure. When you get exposed to the asbestos, you'll get asbestosis, which is a parenchymal disorder. You'll get a pleural disease like benign asbestos pleural effusion or a benign plague. Or sometimes the patients may get malignancies. The malignancies include lung cancers and malignant mesotheliomas. Coming to asbestosis, as I said, it is a fibrotic disorder which includes the lung parenchyma and interstitium. So it is a slowly progressive diffuse pulmonary fibrosis. And you get asbestosis if the exposure has taken place for at least 10 years before the disease becomes manifest. So after 10 years of exposure, you will be able to get this asbestosis, not immediately. So coming to the pathology, the histopathological diagnosis include the presence of asbestos bodies in association with interstitial pulmonary fibrosis. What is the difference between asbestos body and a ferruginous body? A good pathological terminology. Asbestos bodies are transparent asbestos fibers with a coating of iron and protein. When it comes to ferruginous bodies, which are also seen in asbestosis, this ferruginous body is nothing but asbestos body plus other mineral particles such as glass, talc, iron, or carbon. Asbestos body and ferruginous body can be differentiated with the help of electron microscopy. Asbestos bodies are transparent, whereas ferruginous bodies, due to admixture of mineral particles, it is opaque. Coming to the clinical findings, many of the people who got asbestosis will be asymptomatic. But if at all they throw any symptoms, the symptoms, the earliest symptom include dyspnea on exertion. Coming to the physical examination findings, you'll have bibasilar, fine, and inspiratory crackles, which are nothing but your Velcro crackles, which are seen usually in IPF, but it is the same finding is seen in many other diseases. One of the best examples could be asbestosis. And a few people will be having clubbing and copper malaise. That is nothing but your right heart will be failing due to a primary disorder inside the lung. Coming to evaluation of asbestosis, the history of asbestos exposure is very important. So you need to ask whether the person is working in any ship industry or something like that, which I have shown you in the previous slide. Then you will be subjecting the patient to pulmonary function testing, where you'll most of the times you'll be finding what? You'll finding a restrictive type of lung disease with a decreased total lung capacity and decreased DLCO. Coming to chest radiograph, here you could find in this early asbestosis some fine reticular shadows in the lower zones, which are difficult to appreciate. But when it comes to advanced asbestosis, you'll find fibrotic lesions in the lower zones. Lower zones, you find fibrotic lesions, you have to think about asbestosis. When you find the fibrotic lesions in the upper zones, then your differential diagnosis will be berylliosis, radiation fibrosis, extrinsic allergic alveolitis, ABPA, silicosis, tuberculosis, sarcoidosis. The upper zone predominant diseases, these are, I'll go with the mnemonic breasts, berylliosis, radiation fibrosis, extrinsic allergic alveolitis, and ABPA, silicosis, tuberculosis, and sarcoidosis. When it comes to the lower zone predominance, you have to think about IPF and also the asbestosis. Coming to HRCT findings of asbestosis, you'll find a subpleural linear densities parallel to the pleura. And you'll have basilar and dorsal lung parenchymal fibrosis with septal fibrosis. And you'll have coarse honeycombing. You'll have small holes arranged in stacks in the layers, predominantly in the lower zones of the lungs. This is nothing but honeycombing in advanced disease. And you'll also find pleural plaques. So here is a beautiful picture showing the pleural plaques. These are your ribs. These are your ribs, but this is not your rib, my friend. This is your pleural plaque. And you'll also find small holes. These are nothing but honeycombing. And you'll also find the traction bronchiectasis and the septal thickening. So this is the finding that you find in case of asbestosis. What is the management? There is no specific management for asbestosis. You have got only the supportive measures. If at all any person gets this parenchymal fibrosis, you'll have to ask him to quit smoking because smoking further deteriorates his situation. And the other important thing, sir, if there is an oxygen failure, that is the respiratory failure, you have to give him supplemental oxygen. And these patients are more prone to respiratory infections. So what all you can do is you have to give appropriate antibiotic therapy if they throw any respiratory tract infection-like symptoms. And you have to give pneumococcal influenza vaccination. Here we go with a question. Because this topic is more or less theoretical, I wanted to put a few MCQs. This is how you get questions in various entrance examinations. Occupational lung disease is not a good question for your theory, but it is a very good question for your objective test like NEET. So coming to the first question, a worker from the cement industry. See, this is the catch point. You have to look into this question, what industry he's working in. Got a chest x-ray as a part of his routine health checkup. What could cause the findings in the chest x-ray? A, berylliosis, B, tuberculosis, C, asbestosis, and D, silicosis. Anyone can unmute your mic and you can just give the answer. What are the findings that you find and what could be the possible option? Anyone? Can anyone comment on this chest x-ray? Don't feel shy. As we are dealing with asbestosis, obviously the answer would be asbestosis. But the thing is, here you find pleural plaques. Actually, it is an asbestos-related lung disease. It should be like this. Actually, asbestosis is nothing but a lung parenchymal disease. This is something called holy leaf sign. The answer is asbestos-related lung disease. that is nothing but a pleural disease, pleural plaques. So past exposure to asbestos is specifically indicated by pleural plaques, that is thickening or calcification along the parietal pleura, particularly along the lower lung veins, the diaphragm and the cardiac border. And in a few individuals, you will find BAPE. What is BAPE? Benign pleural effusion. Benign asbestos pleural effusion is nothing but BAPE. And this fluid is typically serous or bloody exudate, and the effusion may be slowly progressive, but sometimes it may result spontaneously. Here is the next question, guys. A woman works for a company that manufactures roofing sheets with asbestos. And the company doesn't provide her with personal protection equipment. Which of the following asbestos-related cancer is commonly seen in such workers? Here are your options. Pleural mesothelioma, peritoneal mesothelioma, adenocarcinoma of lung, and laryngeal carcinoma. Can any one of you tell the correct answer? If you are saying it as a pleural mesothelioma, then you're absolutely wrong. I'll tell you the reason. The answer is adenocarcinoma. Lung cancer is the most common cancer associated with asbestos exposure. So here you have the only lung cancer which is present is adenocarcinoma of the lung. It can be any type, but adenocarcinoma of the lung, it can be any histological type, but adenocarcinoma of the lung is the most common type. And the persons with more exposure are at a greater risk of disease. In addition, smoking plus asbestos exposure results in greater risk than what would be expected from additive effect of each factor. So this is a crazy combination, you know, a deadly combination. Smoking and asbestos exposure. You have to stop smoking and you have to reduce the exposure to the asbestos. Coming to the malignancies, the other malignancies other than lung cancer, the other malignancies include mesothelioma, which can be both pleural and peritoneal, are associated with asbestos exposure. In contrast to lung cancers, these tumors do not appear to be associated with smoking, whereas lung cancers are associated with smoking. The second type of pneumoconiosis that which we are going to discuss about is silicosis. Silicosis is a disease which is caused by inhalation of free crystalline silica. I said you, silica is nothing but silicon dioxide, whereas silicate is silica with some other mineral. In case of asbestos, that mineral is actually magnesium. So when you only inhale silica, free crystalline silica, otherwise quartz, we call it as quartz. So when you inhale that, you'll be getting a disease called silicosis. And we'll classify silicosis. The silicosis is classified into three major types. One is acute, the second thing is accelerated, and third is chronic. This is when you get the disease, that is, you get this silicosis within few weeks to 4 years after the exposure. And coming to accelerated silicosis, that is you get silicosis from somewhere between 4 and 10 years after the initial exposure. And chronic silicosis is any silicosis that you get after 10 years after the initial exposure. And this chronic silicosis is divided into simple and complicated silicosis. This complicated silicosis is otherwise called progressive massive fibrosis. Here is the next question on silicosis. Which among the following is a common concern for the people working in sandblasting industries? A, asbestosis. B, silicosis. C, is farmer's lung. D, is berylliosis. The answer is silicosis. Asbestosis, we have seen shipbuilding industries and these asbestosis, cement sheets, all these things are included under asbestosis. And here is the risk factor for silicosis. The occupations include, this is the one which is very important, quarrying and stone cutting, foundry works, and sandblasting, including denim sandblasting. All these things are very important for acquiring the disease. The next question. A 45-year-old man comes to emergency room with an acute onset of dyspnea. He works in the sandblasting industry for about a year now. He works in the sandblasting industry. He came to emergency room with acute onset shortness of breath, and the pulmonologist ordered a CT scan, and you have seen this CT scan. And what is the comment? Which among the following option actually suits with this disease? Can you say me? What is this pattern? This is... I think somebody is chatting, I guess. Yeah, what is the pattern? The pattern that you see is, it's a crazy paving pattern. Crazy, 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 crazy pattern. So crazy paving pattern is actually ground glass opacity with a septal thickening. You have this crazy paving pattern, which you find it on the pavements, no? on the beach road and everything, you find this type of flooring. This is something called a crazy paving pattern, which is generally seen in pulmonary alveolar proteinosis, which is due to a deficiency of granulocyte monocyte colony stimulating factor. But the other differential diagnosis where you find this crazy paving pattern is silicosis. Given the history, looking into the CT, here the comment is acute silicosis. Ideally, crazy paving pattern is seen in pulmonary alveolar proteinosis, but in case of acute silicosis also, you will be able to find crazy paving pattern. So acute silicosis is workers heavily exposed through sandblasting in confined spaces, and clinical presentation is very acute. And what is the treatment? There is no particular treatment for acute silicosis. The only thing that is maybe beneficial is whole lung lavage. You will be doing it with the bronchoscopy with single lung ventilation. That is the only one which could be a little bit of help. Coming to the imaging, acute silicosis you will find predominantly in the lower zones. But when it comes to subacute silicosis and chronic silicosis, you'll find it in the upper zones. Asbestosis also you'll find it in the lower zones. Acute silicosis is found in the lower zones. Okay, and this is your beautiful pattern. What is that? Crazy paving pattern. Crazy paving pattern seen in pulmonary alveolar proteinosis and also in acute silicosis. And the next question. A 30-year-old man recently started work in stone cutting industry. The company doesn't use dust control measures. The company doesn't give personal protection equipment. If he works in the similar condition for more than 20 years, which of the following will you most likely see in this HRCT scan? A, typical crazy paving pattern? The answer is no, because this patient, if he works for more than 20 years, then he will be able to get something called a chronic silicosis. Chronic silicosis, you will find small rounded opacities in the upper lobes. If this patient is not provided with any PPE, his HRCT wouldn't be normal. And thick calcified pleural plaques are seen in the case of asbestosis, but not in the case of silicosis. So the answer is small rounded opacities in the upper lobes. Chronic silicosis is further divided into two types. One is simple silicosis, and the second thing is the complicated silicosis. The simple silicosis is nothing but small rounded opacities in the upper lobes. And sometimes in 20% of the population, you'll find a characteristic finding called eggshell pattern. The hilar nodes are calcified and you find this pattern called, you call it as eggshell pattern. And if these nodules conglomerate and become masses of greater than 1 centimeter in diameter, then we call it as complicated silicosis. These masses can become quite large. And when this occurs, this is something called progressive massive fibrosis, where there will be significant impairment of lung function. Which of the following pneumoconiosis is associated with an increased incidence of TB? A, asbestosis. B, silicosis. C, coal workers' pneumoconiosis. D, berylliosis. What could be the answer? Answer is silicosis. I'll tell you the reason why. Complications of silicosis include: silica causes alveolar macrophage dysfunction. In the last time class in the pneumonia, I said alveolar macrophages are very important in preventing major diseases. One is tuberculosis. This alveolar macrophage dysfunction will be there because of the deposition of the silica particles causing lung infections that may involve these cells as a primary defense. So here you get more or less MTB and atypical mycobacteria, and even fungal infections will be quite commoner. So that is a huge risk for getting TB. So we call it a silico-TB, silico-tuberculosis. And the second problem with silica is you'll get more autoimmune connective tissue disorders such as rheumatoid arthritis and scleroderma. So any woman, this type of a history we generally listen to. So recently we have moved to a place which is very nearer to some construction industry. After that, I started getting joint pains, the small joint pains, which are predominantly there while waking up, and it gets resolved when the day progresses. So early morning joint stiffness, these sort of things they will say. This is all because of silica, exposure to the silica, because it has called immunoadjuvant properties. And silica acts as a probable lung carcinogen as well. So it is 1+3 offer, Diwali Dhamaka offer. So what is this? Once you get silica, subsequently you are more prone to this tuberculosis, autoimmune connective tissue disorders like rheumatoid arthritis, and even it is carcinogenic. So here you see in the upper zones of the lung, this is your trachea, which is not bifurcated. So this is the upper zones of the lung. You find small nodules. and these small nodules are more pronounced in the right upper lobe. Here you find it. Okay, this is a finding of chronic silicosis. And the third pneumoconiosis that which we are going to discuss about is the Kolbachus pneumoconiosis. All are important theoretical questions which are similar to silica. See, occupational exposure to cold dust is Kolbachus pneumoconiosis, which you won't be expecting as a bit. With prolonged exposure to cold dust, somewhere around 15 to 20 years, then you will getting small rounded opacities, which you call it as simple Kolbachus pneumoconiosis, something which is similarly resembling to that of simple silicosis. And in addition to Kolbachus pneumoconiosis, the cold dust can cause chronic bronchitis in COPD. COPD is not only caused because of smoking, it is also caused because of various other factors, one which include Kolbachus pneumoconiosis. And the third thing that we need to discuss about is the complicated Kolbachus pneumoconiosis. That is, these nodules conglomerate and form nodules of size, masses of size more than or equal to 1 centimeter. And these masses, when conglomerate, causes progressive massive fibrosis. So this PMF is the term which is included for both your chronic silicosis as well as the complicated Kolbachus pneumoconiosis. So let's discuss about a question now. A 35-year-old coal worker presents with difficulty in breathing on exertion for last 2 years. Chest X-ray was performed. What does it show? A. Emphysema. B. Reticulonodular nodules. C. Pulmonary fibrosis. D. Cardiac atrophy. Thinking coal worker's pneumoconiosis, most of you would be putting this as an option, reticulonodular infiltrates, but that is not the case. Look into the X-ray. These lungs are actually hyperinflated. They are hyperlucent lungs. The heart is actually tubular in shape. The domes of the diaphragm are actually flattened. And there is, look at this. These are, the domes are so flattened, they have become, the scalloping of the domes of the diaphragm has happened. So there are inverted domes. So because of hyperinflation of the lungs, you got this type of chest X-ray. And we call this as emphysema. That's what I have told you, right? In addition to Kolbachus pneumoconiosis, cold dust can cause COPD. So the answer is emphysema, but not reticulonodular infiltrates. Where do you find a reticulation? This is normal vasculature, dude. Normal vasculature. Where are the nodules? I don't find any nodules here. These are the hyperinflated. If it is a reticulonodular infiltrate, then the lungs won't be this much big. It is fibrosis, right? So the fibrosis will make your lungs to shrink, not to expand. What is Kaplan syndrome? It is rheumatoid arthritis plus pneumoconiosis, or is it because of rheumatoid arthritis plus anterior uveitis? Option C, sarcoidosis, arthritis. D, delusional misidentification syndrome. I'm not a psychiatrist, so definitely this is not an option. Sarcoidosis plus arthritis. This is not a sarcoidosis class. Obviously, this wouldn't be the answer. Rheumatoid arthritis plus anterior uveitis. I'm not a rheumatologist. So the answer is rheumatoid arthritis plus pneumoconiosis. This question, I got it for my final year MD exam. What do you mean by Kaplan syndrome? Kaplan syndrome is nothing but rheumatoid arthritis plus pneumoconiosis. This pneumoconiosis may be silicosis or coal workers pneumoconiosis. It is first time described in coal miners. Therefore, they generally, the bit goes like this. Rheumatoid arthritis plus coal workers pneumoconiosis. But it can be rheumatoid arthritis plus silicosis also. Combination of pneumoconiotic nodules plus seropositive rheumatoid arthritis. So when you do a rheumatoid factor, it will be positive. And the patient will also be having pneumoconiosis, exposure to the either to the silica or to the coal. This is what we call it as Kaplan syndrome, very important. The next pneumoconiosis is chronic beryllium disease. So chronic beryllium disease is, which is very similar to your sarcoidosis. It is a chronic granulomatous inflammatory disease similar to sarcoidosis. Then occupational exposure to high technology electronics, the alloy ceramics will lead to chronic beryllium disease. And CBD is to be differentiated from sarcoidosis by a very important response called a delayed hypersensitivity response to beryllium. So the test that is commonly employed for berylliosis is Bell-PT test, that is beryllium lymphocyte proliferation test. And coming to chest imaging, the nodules are present along the septal lines, just like in sarcoidosis. And you won't be expecting much of hilar adenopathy in case of berylliosis. But in sarcoidosis, you will have sign called 1-2-3 sign, that is paratracheal lymphadenopathy plus bilateral symmetrical hyperarthropathy. We also call it as Garland sign, also called the pawnbroker sign, also called your judge's wig appearance. In English movies, you will find these judges will be having some typical wig. That is what you find it here in the chest. So these are the findings which you find in sarcoidosis, but not in case of silicosis. I'm sorry, sarcoidosis, but not in the case of berylliosis. The PFT is showing the restrictive or obstructive ventilatory defect. You cannot exactly say that this is the one which is going to cause restrictive, because airways are also included. Okay, and you'll have a reduced DLCO. Fiber optic bronchoscopy and doing a biopsy is important. You find specific CD4 T cells in the granulomatous inflammation seen on lung biopsy. And this is one important thing. Susceptibility HLA-DP alleles that have a glutamic acid in position 69 of the beta chain. These are the guys who are more prone to berylliosis. And this is a small topic called hard metal pneumoconiosis, which is the last type of pneumoconiosis that which we are going to discuss under the heading of pneumoconiosis, which we get because of exposure to the tungsten carbide. And the tungsten carbide includes cobalt. So exposure to cobalt causes hard metal pneumoconiosis. Okay, diamond polishing is one industry which is associated with the use of cobalt. Cobalt causes hard metal pneumoconiosis. And coming to hypersensitivity pneumonitis, this is the one which we get because of exposure to organic dust molds. The hypersensitivity pneumonitis is otherwise called extrinsic allergic alveolitis, EAA. Is a pulmonary disease that occurs due to inhalational exposure to a variety of antigens, leading to inflammatory response of the alveoli and small airways. You get exposure to an antigen, and how my body is reacting to that antigen is nothing but a hypersensitivity pneumonitis. Farmer's lung is due to A. histoplasmosis, B. coccidioidomycosis, C. dermophilic actinomycetes, and D. cryptococcosis. Your answer is dermophilic actinomycetes. This is very important. So my intention is you get questions like this. You'll be given one thing and you'll be asked to find out the antigen in the MCQs. This is how the questions come. Farmer's lung, dermophilic actinomycetes. Example, this includes dermophilic actinomycetes, includes Saccharospora rectivirgula. So the bagosis is caused by dermophilic actinomycosis. Mushroom's workers lung is also caused by dermophilic actinomycosis. Potato riddler's lung, dermophilic actinomycosis. Wine maker's lung, botrytis. So this is how you are going to get the questions in your exams too. So when you get exposed to the bird antigens, then you get a bird fancier's disease. Then you get exposed to fish meal dust, fish meal workers. I'm leaving this to you. You somehow you have to cram this, you have to mug up these things in order to answer these questions. A simple memory based question, somehow we have to put some mnemonic or the other to remember these things. If you find a good mnemonic, then please let me know, because this is very important for my entrance exam as well, DM. This includes the other occupational and environmental exposures will also cause. One is humidifier fever. It includes a variety of diseases. Hot tub lung. You get the hot tub lung because of the antigen Mycobacterium avium complex. Monday gastritis or Monday fever is due to bagasosis, bisseniosis, berylliosis. I'm sorry, man. Monday gastritis or Monday fever is due to bagasosis, bisseniosis, berylliosis, Bornholm's disease. What might be the answer? Your answer is bisseniosis. Yeah, bagasosis is exposure to sugarcane. Bisseniosis is exposure to the cotton. Berylliosis is exposure to the beryllium. And Bornholm's disease is exposure to, actually it is because of Coxsackie virus. See, Monday chest tightness, why do we get a Monday fever? I'll tell you. These workers working in the cotton industry, they get exposed to the cotton dust from Monday to Saturday. Saturday they go to their home, and Sunday they will get a leave, which is a holiday actually. So gradually the symptoms get subsided on Sunday, and once they come back to the duty on Monday, they will get exposed to the cotton dust again, and they will feel some chest tightness on Mondays. but not in the remaining days, because they are slowly getting acclimatized to that cotton dust as the days progress in a week. So they will get fever or chest tightness on Mondays, but not in the remaining days. So this is something called dyssyniosis, Monday chest tightness or Monday fever. Hope it is clear. What is true regarding dyssyniosis? Dyssyniosis is A, SOB resolves after cessation of exposure. B, similar to chronic bronchitis and emphysema. And C, present as mediastinal fibrosis. And D, eosinophils are prominent in bowel. The answer is SOB results after cessation of exposure. That's what they get. They get the relief in Sundays because they won't get exposed to this cotton dust on the Sundays. So pathophysiology, pure theoretical aspects, which you might get questions from this pathophysiology. That's why I've included in bold letters. It is an immune-mediated condition. What? HSP is an immune-mediated condition. It involves the distal airways and alveoli. It is predominantly a Th1 inflammatory pattern, and Th17 lymphocytes may also be a part of the pathophysiology. The presence of precipitating IgG antibodies against specific antigens suggests as a prominent role for adaptive immunity in the pathophysiology of hypersensitivity pneumonitis. Toll-like receptors, downstreaming signal proteins such as MYD88 are activated in HP, leading to neutrophil recruitment. And there is a certain polymorphism in genes, including TAP1, major histocompatibility complex 2, have been observed in the pathophysiology of HP. The clinical presentation, here you have three major types of hypersensitivity. One is acute, the second thing is subacute, the third is chronic. In acute hypersensitivity, after getting exposed to some antigen, for example, I have gone to Hyderabad. Hyderabad is full of pigeons. I got exposed to that pigeon feather. That antigen I got exposed. So it manifests within 4 to 8 hours following exposure to the inciting antigen, often intense in nature. You'll get fever, chills, and malaise. You think it is upper respiratory tract infection, but it is actually a type of hypersensitivity pneumonitis. It is a hypersensitivity reaction. The symptoms resolve within hours to days. Okay. In case of subacute hypersensitivity, see, you get the respiratory symptoms more gradual over the course of weeks. In case of chronic hypersensitivity pneumonitis, more gradual onset of symptoms than subacute hypersensitivity with progressive dyspnea, cough, weight loss, clubbing of the digits will be seen. So how do you diagnose hypersensitivity pneumonitis? Hypersensitivity pneumonitis based on a thorough clinical history. You'll put a checkbox and you'll tick all the important things, and you will be able to come to a little bit of a suspicion that, okay, this might be hypersensitivity pneumonitis. Chest X-ray is non-specific. Acute and subacute hypersensitivity pneumonitis, you'll get ill-defined micronodular opacities and hazy ground glass opacities. And in chronic hypersensitivity, nothing is left. The overall lung will be fibrosed. This is a beautiful picture. This is called your head cheese pattern in hypersensitivity pneumonitis. Here you find two different shades. Like this is a black shade, this is a white shade, black shade, a white shade. So this is something called a mosaic attenuation. This is because of air trapping. This is because of your pneumonitis. A typical pattern you find it in the case of hypersensitivity pneumonitis, head cheese pattern. In the pulmonary function test, it can be either restrictive or obstructive because airways are also included. And DLCO is actually reduced. And the serum precipitins, IgG antibodies against specific antigens can be useful agent in the diagnosis of hypersensitivity. What we generally do in our clinics. If the patient comes with some history, sir, I have gone to somewhere, I got exposed to some antigen. And after that, I have gone to somewhere and I got these symptoms, he'll say like that. So taking a thorough history by ticking those check box, we'll have some diagnosis of hypersensitivity pneumonitis. Then we will be sending the patient's blood to hypersensitivity panel. And we will be looking into the precipitating IgG antibodies. There you'll have in that panel includes a whole lot of various antigens against which you'll have this antibody protection. So based on that, you'll get the result and we will be able to note that, okay, this patient might be having a hypersensitivity pneumonitis. This is the question, which is interesting. Ball of a patient shows foamy macrophages with decreased CD4 to CD8 ratio. What is the diagnosis? Sarcoidosis, hypersensitivity pneumonitis, organizing pneumonia, and diffuse alveolar hemorrhage. At least one of you, please unmute your mic and please tell me the answer. One from your class. Any one of you? If you are saying it is hypersensitivity pneumonitis, then you are wrong, because the answer is organizing pneumonia. I'll tell you. The CD4 to CD8 ratio in hypersensitivity pneumonitis is definitely reduced, because you'll have more or less CD8 count will be increased. Therefore, yeah, this part is right. You'll have a decreased CD4 to CD8 ratio, but you don't find foamy macrophages in hypersensitivity pneumonitis. Instead, you find it in organism pneumonia. So the answer to this question is organism pneumonia, but not HSP. Ball is showing lymphocytosis. That's what I told. CD8 lymphocytes are the one who predominate. Therefore, the ratio will be less. CD4 to CD8 ratio is more in the case of sarcoidosis. Remember that there, the CD4 counts will be damn high. You remember this? A HIV patient doesn't get sarcoidosis. Do you know the reason why? Because HIV patient CD4 count will be so less, man. In order to get sarcoidosis, you have to have more CD4 count. The CD4s will be, lymphocytes will be causing more problem to the person who is having sarcoidosis. That's why the pathophysiology is very important. If you simply study like, okay, the CD4 counts will be less in HIV, CD4 counts will be more in sarcoidosis, it's not like that. It's not going to happen. You have to link. You won't be getting HIV, sarcoidosis in case of HIV. This is how, if you study, it will be more interesting. Interlink one topic to the other. So CD4 counts will be more in the case of sarcoidosis. The counts will be CD4 to CD8 ratio will be less in the case of hypersensitivity pneumonitis. And the lung biopsy is actually showing the presence of non-gasating granulomas in the vicinity of small airways. The treatment includes acute hypersensitivity pneumonitis will resolve on its own. You don't have to intervene. Subacute and chronic forms, you have to give steroid. In advanced cases of chronic hypersensitivity pneumonitis, there will be extensive lung fibrosis. By the time you diagnose this disease, the lungs are actually fibrosed and the person becomes a respiratory cripple. So the only option which we are left with is the lung transplantation. Here is the end of the occupational lung diseases. I have discussed something about pneumoconiosis and the disorders under pneumoconiosis, like asbestosis, silicosis, coal workers pneumoconiosis, chronic beryllium disease, and a few words about the heart metal pneumoconiosis, and discussed a few important points about hypersensitivity pneumonitis and how to deal with such individuals. Hope this class is informative. I know it is a boring topic to discuss about, but questions are expected, more or less a theoretical topic. You don't find these type of diseases in your practice, but somehow I managed to say a few words about it. Thanks for your patience, Lizzie. Somebody has given me a reply as well. Thanks, dude. 1780-70942. Okay then. Are there any questions? If you want to ask any questions, then you can ask me. Okay then.